Gnithrith, Gnrith, Kudwilm.
Oh no.
Lzrit, Sublilith.
The Cthulhu dance craze is spreading.
I will admit right off the bat, I'm going into this review with a bit of a bias. This is the first Sherlock Holmes game I've played. It is a good trip down memory lane, but the Awakened remake also hinted at a Nemesis remake sometime down the line, though it's not confirmed yet. So, if it does come out, I will have covered its predecessor as a reference. Plus, putting together an hour-long review and comparison for The Awakened made me realize the worthwhile pain of creating a video. I'm not going to make stuff that long again for a while. Though Nemesis is a sequel to Sherlock Holmes The Awakened, Moriarty didn't regain his sanity to get revenge on Holmes. That should be apparent from the box art. Instead, Holmes and Watson face a new, original adversary named Arsène Lupin. He has been referenced in The Awakened as a criminal who committed several daring thefts, one of which Watson describes here.
He seduced a young Italian princess in order to rob her of a priceless set of diamond jewelry that once belonged to the Medici. These jewels were to be part of the lady's dowry on the occasion of her marriage to the son of a wealthy, influential Sicilian.
Lupin has been on Holmes's mind for a while, but it seems Lupin is now on England's doorstep, with a mysterious letter inviting Holmes to a game of cat and mouse to stop some thefts Lupin says he will commit. Oh, and the stakes are the pride and honor of England, because a lone Frenchman stealing from England would be seen as humiliating. Given their past conflicts, it does make sense. First, a quick disclaimer as to how the game runs. Like The Awakened, I managed to get it running with a hitch. I tried running it on my laptop, which has an RTX 3060. It did not boot up at all. It ran on my home computer, which has an RTX 2070, the same system on which I played both Awakened games. So just know that your results may vary. Though it runs well, there are a couple of glitches here and there. Most of them are visual, such as statues turning black, or a door that looks closed that can be walked through. For those of you who have watched my Awakened review and are wondering, yes, Dark Mage Watson does indeed make his return, though he hasn't done anything drastic to prevent me from saving my game. Instead, he only blocked my path once, but I have the God-given power of fast travel. So, with that out of the way, much about Nemesis is pretty one-to-one with The Awakened, but there are a couple of notable changes and improvements, especially in the presentation. The same panning camera introduction already clarifies that this will be more lighthearted than its predecessor. The sunny skybox, the brighter lights, and the visuals. It's not The Awakened, where the brightness did not always fit the aesthetic it aimed for. Nemesis's visuals are much more consistent, and the lighting is more of an improvement. The sources are accurate and distinct, with street lamps, chandeliers, and a few well-lit torches. Even at nighttime, the skybox looks redone and redrawn. Just don't walk while observing, otherwise the illusion breaks. Though I will say that the areas are more lifeless than in The Awakened. Baker Street feels like the 2020 lockdown, except the bar is open. The levels make up for this in size, detail, and relevancy. We're facing a renowned thief in London, so the locations are well known and have historic value. For example, the National Gallery hosts various paintings and artists, which Holmes can elaborate on. More on him later. The Tower of London is just this vast structure that feels lived in with its dorm and cloakroom, along with a rich history given by the ruins both above and below. The British Museum is a place I have mixed feelings about playing. It's not related to the aesthetics. The various exhibits and displays are fascinating, but it's the puzzles in the museum itself. I'll explain why in the gameplay section. I also liked that every part of the levels felt accounted for. Nearly every room has a purpose for either items or puzzles, which makes exploration rewarding. Another aspect they changed for the better is the music. The themes for each level loop well, and more frequently than in The Awakened, and most of them are famous musical pieces. These tracks are consistently loud, elegant, and fit well with the tone and setting of 1890s London, contrasting with The Awakened and its few somber, tribal, or out-of-place but welcome tunes. They're also pleasant to listen to while solving puzzles. The character models are pretty much on the same level of quality as The Awakened, though there is a twist. Remember the character models that walked through Baker Street in the previous game? Yeah, they have livelihoods now. They have voices.
Ah, Mr. Holmes, such a tragedy. Have you seen what these crooks have done to my museum?
Can't you just feel the anger and frustration in the director's voice? Oh, and you'll see these two models used more than once. I don't mean these specific characters, but instead you'll see them playing as entirely different people, color swapped, and with dissimilar voice actors.
Oh, not in the slightest, but I do know that it's rather pleasant watching all these pretty young men in uniform. Our inspector, you are quite the joker, you are going to jail, and everybody... Oh, hello, gentlemen.
I don't know what led to these decisions, but it's nice to see the models given purpose instead of being forgotten. As to the main characters themselves, Holmes and Watson retain their looks from The Awakened, but Holmes's voice is, for some reason, much softer. This is the same voice actor Rick Simmons, but it sounds like he's making a voice demo for audio tours.
Tobias and the Archangel Raphael by Adam Elsheimer, German painter. The Archangel should ask what kind of bait he used. This canvas was acquired in 1894 by the National Gallery. It was based on a composition he had previously done.
You know, I actually wouldn't mind this. Granted, Holmes wasn't the loudest voice in the room, but he spoke with a presence, like he was saying something important. For example, here's Holmes in The Awakened.
One of the two is a man of moderate size, very robust, and a mature age. His profession, which will be the key element in our investigation of this affair, will be determined by me within few hours.
And here's Holmes now.
Aeschylus was an ancient Greek philosopher. He had a phobia of enclosed spaces and would never enter a building of any kind. This was as a result of the fact that it was predicted that he would die by being crushed by a roof. Do you know how Aeschylus died, Watson? His skull was smashed by a turtle that fell from the skies.
The other voice actors range from okay to somewhat peculiar. I didn't really have any strong feelings about most of them. They're fine, but didn't match their predecessor's humor or unique personality. One returning character, Barnes the bookseller, has gone through a significant character change after The Awakened, given his more nervous demeanor when we first meet him.
Hello, Dr. Watson? How are you? I didn't hear you enter.
He is one of the characters that stood out to me, and I wanted to know more about him. Sadly, Nemesis does not elaborate much on his development except to move the game along. There isn't much to add for gameplay, at least mechanics-wise. You get third or first-person perspectives, use items or combine them, and solve puzzles. You have the map for fast traveling, documents to review, reports, and logged conversations. I will say that reports and conversations did come in handy in this game on several occasions, but it's still primarily the items, documents, and map tabs that reign supreme. A couple of minor quality of life additions are mainly attributed to the icons. Each one now has a distinct color, and anything you have already looked at is highlighted in green. Those who play The Awakened will feel at home here. What is different about Nemesis versus The Awakened are the puzzles. There are many more of them this time, and most are, in my experience, more reasonably challenging and intellectually stimulating. You get a notice in the beginning that says you should be taking notes, and that's what I've been doing for some of the challenges, and it felt more rewarding to solve them. If I had to describe the game's overall difficulty, it would be that it ascends as you go through each level fairly slowly. But later levels introduce difficulty spikes that I had to look up a guide for. The museum features the toughest challenges and the most tedium, primarily in the library. In short, it starts with finding a riddle in the library by locating a specific book. You then search what the riddle alludes to and find the next book with the following riddle, repeat ad nauseum. Something I missed in both The Awakened and Nemesis is that there is a hint system and it is very detailed, giving step-by-step instructions on how to solve the puzzles. Though I had mistaken it for a tutorial tab, so I never used it. Instead, I looked up this guide. Highly recommend it. I won't go in depth with the puzzles like I did in the last review. I think these are better experienced than described. Though, I will argue in favor of them in this game. To me, building the game around intricate puzzles is crucial. You're not going around the world figuring out who's in charge of Cthulhu's fan club. You already know the culprit this time, and you're playing his game. Lupin constantly challenges you with riddles and puzzles, edging you further to try and get ahead of him instead of playing catch-up. Though I could do without a couple of the puzzles, most of them feel interwoven with the mystery, and taking them out would be like taking the game's identity away. This leads into the story. As I said in the presentation, this is a more lighthearted tale than its predecessor. It's kinda campy, but not in a wacky way. It feels more consistent, but the blend of horror and camp made The Awakened stand out. What makes Nemesis stand out is its villain, Arsène Lupin, who is very hard to describe without spoilers. So, if you want to avoid that, here's the timestamp on screen and in the description. So, let's break down how great of a mastermind Lupin is. He sneaks into the National Gallery to steal a famous painting, breaks into the Tower of London to spread the London Ravens throughout the entire premises, infiltrates the British Museum to surf away on the Rosetta Stone, and then penetrates Buckingham Palace's defenses to steal a kiss from Queen Victoria herself. Oh, this game. All the while, he leaves intricate riddles and puzzles for Holmes to solve. But that's just scratching the surface. These robberies are both an insurance policy and a diversion. Lupin knows that Holmes would never disclose any of these thefts to the public, lest all of England and Scotland Yard, who are assisting in the search, be considered fools.
Watson, get a hold of yourself, man. You aren't dreaming. Our mission, England's honor.
I am going to call a council of war, and I want you to know that no matter who you are, all contact with the press is categorically forbidden and will be punished in exemplary fashion.
Lupin also used these as ploys to cover his real target, the crown jewels locked away inside Big Ben. I might be alone in thinking this, but Lupin feels like what Holmes would be if he were a criminal instead of a detective. He's not like Moriarty, who is just on the same intellectual level as Holmes, but would rather work in the shadows and rely on henchmen. Lupin is almost one-to-one with Holmes regarding skill, smarts, and risk. For those of you who have played the game, you're probably thinking about when Lupin disguises himself as an artist to case the gallery. But I'm also talking about when Lupin disguises himself as a journalist under the false pretense that he's helping Watson in exchange for a favor, only for that favor to be breaking into the British Museum for journalistic reasons. That's definitely something criminal Holmes would do. Now, this is not to say that Lupin is perfect. For example, while pretending to be an artist, he knocks over a large vase with soil, leaving footprints and an explicit identifier for Holmes to track later in the game. Also, there are traces of painted footprints left by Lupin's accomplice after the theft. Holmes got ahead of Lupin when determining that the Rosetta Stone was the next target. Lupin even admits to the Queen that breaking into her chambers may have been the point where he would have been caught, though the love-struck Victoria gives him an out. However, given that Lupin wants us to chase him, it's hard to tell whether these mistakes were genuine or if they were left for Holmes to find. Sometimes, I question whether the painted footprints were intentional, or if he soloed the heists and left the false trail at the art gallery to fool Scotland Yard into thinking there was an accomplice. You'd never know what was a mistake by Lupin or a genuine attempt at misdirection. Lupin knew one thing. If anyone ever had a chance to catch him, it would be Sherlock Holmes. Which he does by burning the rope Lupin would have used to carry the crown jewels away, and then breaking the door down with a cannon.
As you can surmise by the plumes of smoke emanating from the rope originating from this window, it, let's say, suffered by my hand, and there's no chance that it'll support your weight nor the items that I imagine you to be carrying.
You impress me, Mr. Holmes.
Okay, condensing time. Holmes and Lupin congratulate each other on a contest well played, or, in their opinion, a war well fought. Lupin agrees to give the location of his loot, and never to return to England. In exchange, Holmes lets him leave, and England's honor remains intact. It ends with Holmes explaining everything to Watson, and both agree to never make the events known to the public. So, would I recommend Sherlock Holmes' Nemesis? Well, for this game, it depends. Do you like solving complex problems and puzzles? This may be up your alley. There are many puzzles to solve, which are more rewarding and engaging for the intellectual player. If you haven't looked through my spoilers and want to experience the story, use the hint system or look up a guide before entering. Notably this one. While Nemesis doesn't have the same charm as The Awakened, Lupin as an antagonist really drew me in. The similarities with Holmes, his overall plan, and just how clever of a villain he is kept me going until the end credits. Even in the spoilers, I didn't get into the finer details of Lupin's machinations, so it's worth seeing for yourself. Otherwise, this game is kinda hard to recommend. While I say the puzzles are a fair challenge, the rising difficulty and the tedium of the History Museum will likely push some players away. This is also a point of contention in The Awakened, but I went into more detail about the specific puzzles in that review. I will discuss a few of Nemesis's puzzles in my next video, where I suggest what I believe Frogware should do if considering a Nemesis remake. So, subscribe or follow the channel to catch when it comes out. Also, if you're on YouTube, smash the bell icon to be notified when the video is released. Don't forget to like the video and tell me your thoughts about the game in the comments. Thank you for watching, and for those who are new, welcome aboard.
When you have eliminated the impossible, Lestrade, whatever remains, however improbable, must be the truth.
Wait, that voice line.
When you have eliminated all which is impossible, then whatever remains, however improbable, must be the truth.